if at all physically possible, so we can go to the throne room this morning. You all look marvelous this morning.
Thank you. Thank you.
Absolutely beautiful. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord. Father, we thank you, first of all, just for being God. We thank you just for being God. You are high and lifted up, and we lift up your name and the name of your precious Son, Jesus, every single day of our lives. Father, we thank you. We thank you for our lives this day, for the breath in our bodies, because we did not have to open our eyes this morning. And Father, we thank you. We thank you. We thank you we're not in a hospital bed this morning. We thank you we're not being wheeled in a wheelchair this morning. Father, we thank you that we have use of our limbs in the name of Jesus. We have so much to be thankful for. And we do thank you. Father, we thank you for blessing this ministry and our pastors and every single congregant in here, Lord. We thank you that you would bless each and every family that's represented here today in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you for your healing, and may it course through every single body in this room. For we know that there is healing, spiritual, mental, physical, emotional, whatever area we need it in, Father, we can and will be healed in Jesus' name. But that's what your word says. We thank you for your word. We thank you, Father, that you did not create us and just throw us down here on this world and said, have at it. You left us your word. You left us a guidebook that we could use to live our lives and be prosperous and joyful in the process. And Father, we thank you for your word. For every word of yours is true. We can stand on it every single day and not doubt for one second that you love us and you have our best interests at heart. Father, we thank you for blessing. We ask that you would bless each and every nation, each and every head of each and every nation. And Father, bless the leaders of our country. Father, we need to pray for them daily. Daily. But I thank you that the weight of the government is on your shoulders as well. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. We don't have to look to Washington for our fate. And we thank you, Lord. We thank you for blessing our children and our grandchildren and our great-grandchildren and just blessing our seed, Father, like your word said you would. And we just give you praise, 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 praise. We ask that you continue to bless this ministry. Bless us, Lord, and so we can be a blessing to others. We thank you for our tithers and our givers, for we are able to give to someone else, Father, because we have members that support our ministry. And we thank you for that, Lord. Hallelujah. We thank you for the love in this church. We thank you that when you hit that door, you can feel it. Strangers know it when they hit that door, Lord, and we thank you for that. We thank you for that because it is only because of you that they feel that love when they walk in this building. Father, we give you all of our praise, all the honor, and all the glory as that you bless the children today. Father, as we know this program is going to be beautiful, we ask that you loose the Holy Spirit in here, Father. Warm hearts, change minds, and just overall just be joyful in here today. And we thank you that you are the head of this household as we give you praise, honor, and glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
I'd like to share this morning from the book of Matthew. Matthew chapter 28, verses 1 through 7. Matthew chapter 28, verses 1 through 7.
If you need a Bible, please raise your hand.
And it reads, Matthew 28, 1 through 7. Now after the Sabbath, toward the dawn of the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the tomb. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothing white as snow. And for fear of him, the guards trembled and became like dead men. But the angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he has risen, as he said. Come see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples that he has risen from the dead. And behold, he's gone before you to Galilee. There you will see him, as I have told you." We need to know today that do not seek the living among the dead. He has risen. Amen. Thank you for the reading of the word.
We're going to lift up some praise this morning with some carols for the season. out there now. I love Christmas carols. I do.
Jesus. O come, O come, Emmanuel.
Thank you. you can count on him.
Lord.
It's prayer time.
Hallelujah. 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 Jesus is the healer. He's the deliverer. What else is he?
Comforter.
Savior. Provider. Strong provider. He's a protector. Deliverer. Who else is he? Prince of Peace. Good. Hallelujah. Strong tower. We can run into him and find what?
Help
and safety. He's a counselor. Hallelujah. Good shepherd.
Loyal.
He is loyal. He's faithful. All right. In our prayer time today, I would like you to decree over three people. We're going to do this in 6 minutes. Okay. Decree who Jesus is in their life. We've just given a plethora of answers, okay, to remind you. But pray that into each person's life. Oh Lord, I just speak and decree your lordship in their life, that you're a deliverer, that you're a healer in the name of Jesus. Just name it and then go to the next one. We're not saying name it and claim it. We got it in Jesus' name.
All right. Jump up.
Yeah. thank you that you are provision for all that she needs in Jesus' name. Guys, sit down.
So glad to see your smiling face. Please know it is our sincere prayer that you not leave out of those doors in which the same way you came. God has a special blessing, a word for you. It might be in a song, it might be in a word, it might be in a deed, it might be in a smile, it might be in a hug, but God has something special just for you. Remain standing, we want to serenade you.
Thank you. again. Don't be a stranger.
You're welcome. Amen.
God bless you. We are going to have ministry and song with Psalm Shabbat.
Amen.
My favorite one. Can you tell?
So my seat is gone.
Well,
you know.
Yeah, you know. Let's put some in.
Hurry down, huh? Let me know.
The bags.
The night that Christ was born. You know, this song is so beautiful. If you close your eyes, you can almost envision that night. That's what I love about this song. So I hope it ministers to you, and just put joy in your heart, okay?
What they gonna give you a seat if I get out of the way, nigga?
You okay?
Yes.
Rejoice in heaven, so sweet is the King.
know, y'all choir can sing. I don't know whether y'all know it or not. Hey, let me tell you, them few little folks over there, they not playing when they come up here. They serious about singing for Jesus. And it sounds like, I tell you, yes, it's beautiful. Our inspirational verse comes from Psalm 27:14. Wait on the Lord. That's easier said than done sometimes. Wait on the Lord. Be of good courage while you wait, and he shall strengthen thine heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord. If we did that every single time, we'd probably be a whole lot better off. Am I right? Because you know, we try to fix stuff and do stuff ourselves. We have to wait because he has a plan. We have to wait until we hear it and see it. Yeah. Bible says, and follow the plan. Don't deviate from the plan because yours is not better than his. Trust me. Bible study resumes Tuesday, January the 8th. We will be studying the Sermon on the Mount. That sounds exciting. There are two versions. There are two sessions of Bible study from 1 to 2 p.m. in the afternoon and from 7 to 8 p.m. in the evening. We will also be doing the anger workshop from the beginning. 12 to 1 p.m., 6 to 7 p.m. You got it? The Lord has blessed us. And Doc, I'm going to tell you right now, I got a bag in the car. I'm ready. The Lord has blessed us to have a fruitful avocado and lemon tree. Now, I don't know how many of you have paid attention to the prices of avocados and lemons. I refuse to pay 89 cents for a lemon. I'm not doing that. I will climb over somebody's fence, climb the tree, and give me a lemon before I pay 89 cents for a lemon. Come on now. See, because I can still climb at certain times of the day. Yeah. Can somebody do one of these? I'm paying 89 cents for one lemon? Jesus. So, if you would like to have access to either tree, we don't have no trees out there that we can't touch, do we, Doc? Like in the garden. Tell me now, Doc, before I get back there. Okay, good. Please inform Dr. Wood so arrangements can be made. And please bring your own bag. Okay? Put me down, Doc. I got a bag in the car. I need a lemon. Be sure to check out our website at www.lasfc.org. Secure online giving is available on our website. Also, we have church services and events are available from February until the present. You can also get sermons and events from our YouTube channel by doing a YouTube search for the Los Angeles Shabbat Church. That's exciting. It is. With all the garbage there is on the airwaves and through the media, it's exciting to know there are places you can go and get you some good stuff, okay? So don't forget about that. Is there anyone celebrating a birthday today or during the coming week? Please stand so we can acknowledge your birthday.
Ain't nobody standing.
No birthdays?
Not even there.
She got her hand up. She got her hand up. She is consistent. Yes, she is.
Every week.
Okay, so no birthdays. Happy birthday again, Leana.
Thank you.
And for those of you with birthdays coming up, We look forward to celebrating with you. Thank you so much for your time.
We don't have to celebrate. Jesse Ornament Hammond.
No. Nope, that's not it.
Wrong.
That's right, it's his birthday.
Wrong. Sorry, Jesse.
Jesse, ready.
Unless she wasn't ready, she should have just gone on. What you got in there?
Pastor wants you to know that the lemons and the avocados are holy.
All right
now. Okay, I have to talk to her about the rest of that.
Pastor Johnson laid hands on those trees when we purchased the property when escrow closed. Okay, so we gave you almost 20, and I told that fruit to be holy. I decreed it, and avocado.
All right.
Guys, get ready. I want to thank all of you who participated yesterday in the memorial service. Many of you work behind the scenes, ushers and directors of cars on the parking lot. And thank you, Mark, for your spirit of excellence, Margaret Winston, who provided the,
picture.
Kleenex and stuff that you don't think about. And so we appreciate the Lord. Come on, let's give everybody, give all of you. You put movement to He has done wonderful things. Amen. So I'm going to ask you to, while we are preparing to listen to our youth, those of you who know how to pray, I'm going to ask you to pray for Kiera. They tell me she's on the way to the hospital, and I think this is a time when I'm usually there, but I'm chilling, and so I'm being great grandmother and whatever. So, many hats. Okay, and so let's prepare to receive our. Father, thank you that you are protecting Kiera and Daylin, and that you are, she has a safe delivery, Lord God, uneventful for the mother and the baby in Jesus' name. We just thank you, Lord, that you're covering them with your blood. There will be no incidents or accidents of any description in the name of the Lord Jesus, and that you will usher those folks in who will acknowledge you.
Yes.
And
you're next.
Give her spiritual support as well as medical support. We thank you, Lord, that it will not be arduous delivery in any way, in Jesus' name. So we just give you glory, give the honor that you're covering them with your blood, in Jesus' name, amen. Let's receive our gift.
Are you guys in the right order? You in the right order? Okay.
Christmas is a time to be the hand of God, touching the hungry, the homeless, those who are lonely, and all those who need your love, His love. But Christmas is also a time for looking ahead. A new year is just around the corner, packed full of opportunities to witness for Him, to share His gospel of peace. Look ahead and dream, plan and prepare. Be courageous, be bold. The future is an open door ready for you to walk through. But most of all, Christmas is a time for looking back. Do that today, won't you? Look back reverently across the centuries to the stable in Bethlehem. Picture the scene. Enter the village. Feel the crisp night air. See your frosty breath and feel the crunch of the gravel as you walk the path towards the inn. Stop at his door and listen to the laughter inside. Now step around the corner to the back of the inn and pause before the stable. Smell the fragrance of hay and straw. Let the warm glow of the stable lantern touch your face. Hear the cry of a tiny infant. Now wait and listen. Hear the distant strains of singing angels. Step inside the stable and marvel at what you see. Draw near, come close. Don't be afraid. This is the Lord of the universe come down to be with you. In your heart, kneel before your Lord. Come worship and adore. Why? Because Christmas is a time for looking at the Lord Jesus.
Christmas billboards. Bombarded as we are by radio jingles, slick TV ads, splashy newspaper inserts, and dazzling store displays, we need to work at staying single-minded about the meaning of Christmas. We know that Jesus entered human history quietly on a cold winter's night in a dark little stable. There were no jingles, billboards, or glitzy television commercials to advertise his advent. But that's not to say his coming was unannounced. God certainly did advertise the coming of his son long before his birth. Christ's entry into the human family was the culmination of a long line of prophetic statements. Genesis describes him as the seed of the woman. Numbers calls him both star and scepter. Job pictures him as the redeemer. Song of Solomon calls him the rose of Sharon. Isaiah reveals him as the servant of God. Jeremiah names him the Lord our righteousness, and Daniel the Messiah. And Haggai, he is the desire of all nations, and Zechariah the king, and Malachi, the messenger of the covenant, billboards, signposts, and there were more. The city where Jesus would be born, the heralding work of John the Baptist, the journey into Egypt, descriptions of his ministry, his betrayal, his agonizing death on the cross, his resurrection, all were foretold in graphic detail. When you look back on these Old Testament billboards, you wonder how anyone could have missed the coming of the Messiah on that winter night. Yet, so many did. In spite of all those advertisements, people did miss him. Most were either indifferent or blind to the amazing fact that God himself intervened in human history. Even though there seemed to be an air of feverish expectation by the time Christ was actually born, most folks just failed to read the signs. It reminds me of a story I once heard about a woman who lived alone in the hills of the South. In her great mansion, she had many pictures of her hero, Robert E. Lee. One night, in a snowstorm, two men stopped at her house for temporary shelter. She fed them and provided a place for them to rest. Upon leaving, one of the men, who was very distinguished in appearance, gave her a little gift. The woman became curious and asked the other man the name of her gentlemanly guest. "That, ma'am," he replied, "is General Robert E. Lee." Before she could speak, they were gone. She had missed her chance to meet the one who had meant so much to her. And although she had his pictures all over the walls of her living room, she failed to recognize him when he came. Maybe that's what happened the night Jesus arrived. Perhaps the people had preconceived notions about this Messiah of theirs. Certainly they were upon their prophecy. But it obviously took more than just reading the signposts. As in that story, it took more than just hanging up a few pictures. People then and people today need to look for the person, not simply a title, a label, a piece of prophecy, or a name. The Son of God is a person. And today, much like those days nearly 2,000 years ago, we must not miss our chance to meet this marvelous person, the Lord Jesus. Could it be that you've looked past the signs and all the materialistic media hype? Could it be that you've somehow failed to notice his coming, his nearness? The whole Bible is built around the story of Christ and his promise of life everlasting to men. The signs are there that we might believe and understand, know and love, and follow him.
How can this be? Once upon a time, in a galaxy far, far away, an angel left on a journey. He soared across the path of the suns and stars, and he entered another galaxy, a very special galaxy. The angel crossed one solar system after another, past bidding planets to one certain Pacific planet. He entered the Earth's atmosphere, crossing oceans to a bare planet in an obscure corner of the world. It was here the angel arrived at a little town called Nazareth. He flew down streets and alleys to a certain home. Here, his journey across space and time ended. The angel had crossed the universe to stop in front of a dusty little house on the side street in a small village on the edge of a desert. Across eternity and innumerable light years, the angel had come. His message was for neither king nor prince. Caesar was unaware of the visitation. Herod would know soon enough. The angel had been sent to speak to a peasant girl, a young ordinary girl sitting on the edge of her bed in her room in that dusty little house. The angel entered, appeared, and spoke. The words he uttered to the girl were simple and direct. They were startling, which words sent shockwaves across the galaxies. "Greetings, you who are highly favored," the angel said to her. "The Lord is with you. Do not be afraid. Mary, you have found favor with God. You will be with child and give birth to his son. You are to give him the name Jesus. And he will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David. And he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. His kingdom will never end." Artists have tried for ages to capture that moment on canvas. Poets have pondered it. Dreamers have wondered about it. We can only guess what that young peasant girl named Mary must have done. Did she clutch in her blanket? Did she hide behind a pillow on her bed as any teenager might do? Did she gasp, scream, weep, laugh, sit there in a daze? Thanks to scripture, we can at least be sure of what she said. With childlike simplicity, with honest words that only an innocent teen can say, Mary responded to the angel with a simple, direct question. A question that also sent shockwaves across the galaxy. "How will this be?" she asked the angel, "since I am a virgin. And all of the universe and space and time had begun. Never had anything like this happen. God was about to become man. And for this girl from Nazareth would never be the same." As you read these words, ask yourself the same question as Mary. How could this be? It's a simple, direct question, an honest question. So ask yourself, and when you find the answer, God became man for you, you will also never be the same.
Good morning.
Good morning.
A plan behind pain. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world, and everyone went to his own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born. This distance between Nazareth and Bethlehem is no Girl Scout height. It spans over 60 miles of rough and rugged terrain. We can imagine Joseph packing a few belongings and beginning that journey on foot, a donkey back with Mary, running to her 9th month of pregnancy. To talk about unpleasant circumstances, how Mary must have suffered that one journey, Joseph, too, may have been gripped by anxiety over the situation. Can you imagine his thoughts as they traveled toward Bethlehem? Why did the census have to happen now, of all times? What if the baby comes while they're traveling? Where will we stay when we get to Bethlehem? What if the inns are full? When the times come, what if there's no one to help? Will I be able to assist Mary? Would it be terribly hard on her? Would a child be in danger? But if necessary, to make that several-day journey to Bethlehem for more reasons than one. Hundreds of years before, God prompted his prophet to make the town of the future Messiah. Sorry about that. God prompted his prophet to the name town of the future Messiah's birth, the city of David. God used an external circumstance, the Roman census, to have his son born in ancestral city. Now, certainly, it was a great inconvenience to both Mary and Joseph, but unpleasant circumstances often have made of becoming the best part of God's magnificent design. Despite the headache and hardship, the inconvenience and discomfort, God's sovereign timetable was ticked off right on the schedule. This Christmas story has a lesson for us today, because sometimes you and I make the mistake of thinking that the only right things or comfortable things are part of God's design. A good job, robust health, close friends, and comfortable house, money in the savings account, all give us an impression that we must be doing things right. Then, when the inconvenience or discomfort or hardship hits, we wonder what went wrong. Maybe nothing went wrong. Maybe when sleeping, we need to realize our unpleasant circumstances, much like Mary's and Joseph's, often have a way of becoming a beautiful portion of God's magnificent design. God's sovereign timetable is working in the life of your family, too. As hard as they may be, to accept the time, despite the hardship, despite the inconvenience, despite our lack of understanding, God has something in mind. He's in control, and He has a design for life this Christmas season, and through all the seasons of your life. Thank you.
The stable. It was a chilly night in the little Judean town of Bethlehem, the kind of night when you want to escape the cold, damp air and find warmth and security inside a cozy inn. And people crowded tightly into the inn at the end of the street. They left their donkeys and camels in the back stable and closed the door against the night air. Inside the inn buzzed with laughter and chatter. Distant relatives who had not seen each other in years renewed family ties over bowls of hot soup and goblets of wine. They broke bread together, swapping stories of their journeys. A teenage boy strummed his violin in the corner, and several fathers clapped their hands in time to the music. In the rush to serve tables, the innkeeper, balancing a tray of breads and meats, answered a knock at the door. A man calling himself Joseph stood outside, pulling his homespun cloak tightly around his neck. It was late, it was cold, and he and his young wife needed a room. A glance up the innkeeper that the woman was heavy with child. He could barely hear himself talk with so much noise behind him, but he managed to explain that there was no room. Only an empty stall or two in the stable out back. Shrugging his shoulders, the innkeeper quickly apologized and slammed the door. Outside, Joseph stood for a moment, listening to the laughter and sighing. Back in the stillness of the night, very late, the young couple made their way to the stable. And while music and laughter and feasting went on and on, just yards away behind the walls of the inn, the Son of God quietly entered his room. Sometimes the best moments of the Christmas season do not happen during the crowded parties or the rush of holiday preparations. They don't occur in the music and laughter, the camaraderie and feasting. When I think of special Christmas memories, I think of those quiet moments when God unexpectedly surprised me with himself, with an overwhelming sense of his nearness and love. In the midst of so much activity, so much going on, so many days on the calendar filled with appointments and parties, God seeks out the quiet heart and speaks to us in a still, small voice. Think of the stable in Bethlehem. Somehow it stands serene. What a contrast to the celebrating going on in that inn. Who would have supposed? Who would have suspected? If someone had only taken the time to peer out a back window toward the stable. If someone had only dropped what he was doing to leave the party and go check on his donkey. If someone had only slipped away from the festivity for a moment to seek a quiet moment outside. Just think of what they might have witnessed. Perhaps they would have seen the angels. Maybe the shepherds. And yes, even the Son of God. Amen. Take time this Christmas season to step outside the clamor and excitement. Visit the stable and ask God to speak to you in the quiet and serenity and the stillness. He will.
Good morning.
Good morning.
The Christmas pageant.
This is the month when schools and churches all over the country are holding their annual Christmas pageant. Probably the best Christmas pageant story I ever heard was the one about Wally Herman, printed in Guy Post magazine years ago. As the story goes, Wally was 9 that year and in second grade, although he should have been 4th. Most folks in town knew he had difficulty keeping up. He was big and clumsy, slow of movement, and bumpy. Still, Wally was well liked by the other children in his class, all of whom were smaller than he. He was always helpful, the natural protector of the underdog. Wally fancied the idea of being a shepherd with a flute in the Christmas pageant that year. But the director of the play, Miss Lombard, assigned him to a more important role. After all, she reasoned the innkeeper didn't have too many lines. So it happened that the usual large audience gathered for a town's yearly extravaganza of crowns and halos, shepherds, crooks, and beards, and a whole stage full of squeaky voices. But no one on stage or off was more caught up with the magic of the night than Wally Perlman. The time came when Joseph appeared, slowly, tenderly, guiding Mary to the door at the inn. Joseph knocked on the wooden door of the painted bathroom. "What do you want?" Wally said, swinging the door open. "We seek lodging." "Seek it elsewhere." Wally looked straight ahead and spoke vigorously. "The inn is full." "Sir, we have asked everywhere in vain. We have traveled far and are very weary." Wally looked stern. "There is no room in this inn for you." Joseph put his arm around Mary. "Please, good innkeeper, this is my wife, and she is heavy with child and needs a place to rest. Surely you must have some small corner for her." For the first time, Wally the innkeeper relaxed his stiff stance and looked down at Mary. There was a long pause, long enough to make the audience a bit tense with embarrassment. A prompter whispered from the wings, "Your line is, no, be gone." Wally repeated automatically, "Be gone." Joseph sadly placed his arm around Mary, and the two of them started moving away. Wally stood there in the doorway, watching. Suddenly, his eyes filled with tears, and suddenly, this Christmas pageant became different from all the others. "Wait," Wally the innkeeper suddenly blurted out. "Don't go, Joseph." His face broke into a wide smile. "You can have my room." Many people in town thought the program had been ruined. A few, however, the thoughtful ones considered it the most meaningful pageant of all.
Does Christmas get you excited? I love every minute of it. I love the tang of hot apple cider, the aroma of French pies in the oven, the carols by candlelight, and the worship and adoration of Jesus. I'm sure we'll fellowship at Christmas Eve services as always, and then return home for presents and singing. I've got great ideas this year, and I've been buying for months in advance to surprise my family with some very special gifts. All of us will no doubt be thinking of just the right gift for each other, something personal, something unusual, something just right. But as I make a mental list of all those gifts, I can't think of anything better to give than myself. I can give my time, my interest, my love, and appreciation for my mom or dad or sisters, or in the nice direct packages, gorgeous gifts, or net cards. They can never take the place of the time, effort, or energy that you invest in your relationships with family and friends. One friend of mine thought of some very clever gift ideas that really were an investment of his time and energy. He gave the gift of himself, a month of Sundays to help his mom with dishes, five backups whenever his brother might ask, or the promise to stack the firewood high at the back door. You and I should be the best gift that we could ever give to another. What about your gift list this Christmas? Nothing could say more than the time, interest, and love that you give a friend or loved one.
That's what God gave us when he gave himself in the person of Jesus Christ. God so loved the world that he gave, and that's a thing meant to be repeated in the life of every believer this holiday season. So give yourself your love. It is the most valuable gift by far.
Oh, come all ye faithful. Funny how little incidents from childhood seem to linger in the memory from year to year. Christmas sounds and sights and smells unlike a number of such memories. When I hear the carol, Oh, come all ye faithful, I think of a certain music box at my grandmother's. I didn't know all the words to that song. But from minutes on end, I will lay my head against my folded arms on the table and stare at that little glowing church. Mesmerized, I'd hum along with the tune. Years later, that hymn is still a Christmas favorite. Oh, come all ye faithful, joyful and triumphant. I'm so glad I'm among the faithful. Those words of the hymnist include me, and perhaps you who read these words. Who, after all, was the writer addressing with his invitation? Come all ye faithful. Who are the faithful? Well, there are those who are faithful in prayer, faithful in good works, faithful to commitments and vows, made spouses, families, and friends. Faithful in the face of crushing disappointments. Faithful to correct a friend, bringing him back to the path of right and life. In Revelation 2:10, the risen Lord Jesus urges those facing bitter persecution to be faithful, even to the point of death. That same Lord, on the day when he welcomed us into heaven, will reward us with the words, "Well done, good and faithful servant." Faithful means hanging in there. Faithful means persevering and keeping on keeping going until that special day. Faithful means believing what you've always believe, and believing that all the more as the days go by. Faithful means you don't quit no matter what. So come all you faithful. You are the ones who are truly joyful and triumphant this Christmas season, and you are the ones called to adore and to come and adore him. Christ our wonderful and faithful Lord.
Good morning.
Good morning.
As a kid, I loved staying outside in the cold winter snow as long as I could. I look like a Michelin tire guy. I'd be so bundled up. I'd plop myself in the big white drifts and sit there rather amazed that I could see my frosty bread and yet feel so toasty warm. That didn't last long, though. I played until my fingers got cold and numb. But did I have sense enough to go inside? Of course not. I don't know what it is about kids, but they will nearly freeze their tails off and still refuse to come inside the house until they're called. I actually remember thinking, man, my feet are like icicles. I bet mom would call me inside. But would I go inside of my own accord? No, not a chance. Yet when mom finally called me, oh, it felt so good to swing upon the back door and step across the threshold into a warm house. There's a special feeling you get when you walk inside a room, inviting home. It's a sense of belonging, a sense that you're welcome and that you're wanted. And cold air outside only makes you feel all better about being inside.
But why tell me do so many of us insist on staying outside in the cold? You hear stories of how lonely the Christmas season is for many people. You may even count yourself one of them. You long to be a part of the fellowship, the friendship, but you find yourself waiting for someone to call you inside, hoping that someone will invite you in. The Christmas carols only make you feel nostalgic for a home you don't have. Christmas cards only make you feel guilty that you haven't taken time to write and send them yourself. I don't mean to sound cruel, but it's almost as though you want to stay on the outside of the Christmas cheer. And if nobody throws open the front door to welcome you inside their joy, you sternly think to yourself, well, that's me, just one of the holiday statistics of lonely people. You know what? You don't have to wait for someone to call you inside to get warm. You be the one who calls. You be that someone to reach out to another. You welcome someone in and invite him or her to share the season with you. This is what Jesus would do, and this is what he wants from each one of us. There's simply no reason to stay outside in the lonely wind, stubbornly waiting for someone else to make our Christmas special. The Lord Jesus wants you to invite another in. That's the best way to beat the loneliness. It's the best way to come in out of the cold. Thank you.
Outside in. Christmas has to be something you share. The holiday just doesn't make much sense solo. Can you imagine baking cookies, sprinkling little candies on them, arranging them nicely on a silver tray, and then gulping them all down yourself? Great fun, huh? What enjoyment would there be in decorating a tree all by yourself? You string the popcorn, get out the tinsel, hang the ornaments on the limbs, plug in the lights, and then sit there alone? Listen, if you're going to go all out to light the candles, nail mistletoe to the doorway, put on the music, and drape garlands on the banister, you just have to invite someone in to enjoy it all. You have to share the season, or hardly seems worth celebrating at all. One of my favorite moments during the holidays is when the cookies are baked, the tree is trimmed, the candles are lit, the fire is crackling, the music fills the house, and ta-da, you throw open the front door and welcome your friends. Suddenly, the place comes alive with laughter and chatter and hugs and kisses. Welcoming in a friend or a few friends or a whole bunch of friends through your front door is the one moment that best highlights Christmas joy. Joy, you see, must be welcomed from the outside in. That's the beauty of Christmas. It's appropriate that the Lord Jesus entered the inside of history from the outside. Joy came through a door when he crossed the threshold of this world to bring laughter and music into what was otherwise an empty, lonely place. Or sure, the world had all the trimmings, all the right props, all the tinsel. But it was only when Jesus entered in that the world was filled with peace and joy. Oswald Chambers has said, "The Lord came into history from the outside. Jesus Christ is a being who cannot be accounted for by the human race at all. He is God incarnate, God coming into human flesh, coming into it from the outside. Our Lord's birth was an advent, a coming in. And just as our Lord came into human history from the outside, so he must come into me from the outside as well." So there you are, all dressed up in your Christmas best, waiting to share it with someone special. Well, the room will stay empty, lonely, and without music until you invite the Lord to join inside. It only happens when Christ is born in you, a coming into it, much like swinging open the door to let Christmas begin. Jesus stands outside the door of your holiday season. He wants to come in to be born in you. Don't miss out on the best part of Christmas. Open up and welcome him in.
Thank you. I want to acknowledge the writer of these narratives. Her name is Joni Erickson Tada.
Beautiful.
And it's from a book called A Christmas Longing. They did a magnificent job.
Over the phone. But I would like for you to do your part to share the true meaning of Christmas. If a friend opens their Bible to Luke chapter 2, and you open yours, and you read it together, alternate scriptures. I'm sorry. The mic? Now you can hear me. Okay.
If you need a Bible reading.
Oh, you still can hear? Somebody says no. Okay. Luke chapter 2. And if you have your Bible, I'd like for us to read orally today, Luke chapter 2, a portion of it, so that you can be familiar. Yeah, this is a King James Version that I have. Yours may read differently, but I just want you to start with chapter 2, verse 1. When you have it, say amen.
Amen.
Let's read orally. You remember oral reading?
Yes.
In school? And it came to pass in those days that there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. Say tax time.
Tax time.
And this taxing was first made when Serenius was governor of Syria, verse 3. And they all went to be taxed, everyone into his own city. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth into Judea, unto the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and the lineage of David, to be taxed with Mary, his espoused wife, being great with child. Stop right there. It was exciting to me. You know, we have such technology that many times we don't even know how to use it. But I decided to look at census, and it was exciting to see things about my daddy in census before I was ever born or he was ever married to my mother. And you know, and it just went back and back and back, and I thought, who else can I look up? You know, but this is not a new thing being taxed, okay? Six. Thank you. And so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes, laid him in the manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. You know, the Savior came for all people. Somebody told me one day, well, the saved, I said, he didn't come to the saved. He's not just for the saved. God gave this gift to the whole world. But it's just the saved that have received him so far. But he's available. Okay. Verse 11, for unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. You shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of heavenly hosts, praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. And it came to pass, as the angels were gone away from them into heaven, the shepherds said one to another, let us go, now go, even unto Bethlehem, and see this thing which is come to pass, which the Lord has made known unto us. Verse 16. And they came with haste, and they found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger. And when they had seen it, they made known abroad the saying which was told them concerning this child. One moment, please. I see children that are not reading. And you know all Let us pause for them to participate. Because I want you to integrate this in your Christmas heritage. You young people, read the Christmas story in your family. Start that off. Suggest it every year. And you read the Christmas story in Luke chapter 2. Okay, and start it in your family. Because sometimes we forget and need to be reminded, what is it all of us? Amen.
I didn't get Bumblebee Transformer.
He wasn't there.
$100 gift.
We got a multi-million dollar gift.
My name is Jesus. You can't put money on it.
That's right. All the riches are stored up in Christ. All right, I'm waiting for the children, y'all. Young people say in Matthew chapter 2, verse 18.
Give them 1 minute, they're working on it. Bless you.
You know, it's important for children to know the church is for them too. I personally got saved as a child. And this old crazy thing about when I'm 18 now, so I don't have to go to church. I decree in the name of Jesus that our children will know Christ personally in their youth. And not go to church because I had to know you maybe, but I'm 18 now. That's a disgrace. This opportunity to learn Jesus personally. And not, or never really knew it. No. And you know what else, family? I'm going to tell you something. The most diabolic attacks are on our youth. You know? To head us off before we can really walk with Christ. I'm going to challenge you, adults and parents, start giving your children faith projects. Start letting them pray in things now and find out how God works. That God answers their prayer. Yes, I want a so-and-so. That's a nice faith project. Pray and see what you can put your hand to. What labor you can enter into. God was answering my prayer when I was a child because my parents said, well, did you pray about that? It's nice you told me, but did you pray? And I began to find out that he was my personal savior. He would answer prayer, and after a while, my parents were coming to me, baby, pray about something. You understand what I'm saying? You've got to know him in the power of his resurrection, not what grandma and grandpa did and so-and-so believed, not their prayers. You've got to be a prayer. I had teachers keeping me in school. Did you bring your lunch? Are you going to the cafeteria? I'm going to stay with me a lot during lunchtime. And what I had been doing was prophesying to my teachers. Sometimes I'd pass by, I might see something, I'd say something. So they say, how'd you know that? And they started just talking to me and questioning me. And they started having me pray with them. I'm talking about elementary school. We started second grade, and I remember closely. Then they would refer people. Miss Anderson's coming over. Is this the child? Yeah, that's the one. They tell me all that. My husband doesn't come home. Second grade. My husband. Pray. Yeah. People need the Lord. And our children should be light in this world. Amen. Somebody ought not be saying, ooh, they're crazy teens. And you've got to have something for them so that when they go to college, like they did with me and told me in philosophy and all these other classes, there is no God. What about S? Try out this, try out that. I said, what about Jesus? Preach your own gospel. This new year is coming, and we're going to get these kids up to speed.
Amen.
Preaching the gospel. That's fine. You know what? Even if they're like Noah, and it's just for the salvation of their own souls, and nobody else listens,
isn't it nice to know you going to heaven? Because why does the road, who it's on me, that leads to destruction? God, it's you that be divided. There won't be many on the highway of holiness. So they need to understand why their friends back up.
Come on.
You won't drink with me, you won't smoke with me, but they've got to have their own conviction. You can't give it to them, but you can represent Christ and then pray. But give your children faith projects. So they can, until you walk by faith, you don't know God is real. Mama did. Daddy did. So-and-so did. They ought to be prayer warriors. They ought to be answered. They ought to have testimonies about when God answered my prayer. They ought to be praying before the test. When I went to college, in my first year, every time we had tests, I'd ask the teacher, now can I pray for the people before we have the test? Up to you, I don't care. I just jump up wherever I was sitting. I say, anybody that wants, bring it, everybody. I said, you said you were atheist, but I'm... Yeah, I want God to do this for me. I don't want to do nothing for God. We're supposed to make a difference in our lives, and not just when we're adults. Not just when we're adults. That's why the Bible says, train up a child, what? What verse are we on? Then when they're old, they want what? I'm not old yet, but I'm not claiming old.
17.
When they had seen it, they made known abroad the saying which was told them concerning this child. Now that's what we're doing. We're still talking about the Christ and the difference that he's made in our lives. Everybody needs to have a testimony. Everybody needs to be able to tell their own story about who he is in your life. You need your own story.
That's right.
All right. 19. Mary kept all 18. And all they that heard it wondered at those things which were told them by the shepherds. So what were the shepherds doing? Testifying. Telling them. That's right. Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen as it was told unto them. Do you ever glorify God when you hear somebody else's testimony? I love it when people get up and testify, because I can glorify him and I can rejoice with those that rejoice. Amen.
Praise God. All right. Verse 21. And when 8 days was accomplished for the circumcising of the child, his name was called Jesus, which was so named of the angel before he was conceived in the womb.
There was an angel that appeared to Mary.
That's right.
And told her, this child is a holy child, and his name should be called Jesus.
Okay.
And you know what was so obedient? She didn't name him something else. She obeyed. She was a young girl, a teenager. Not a rebellious teenager. She obeyed. Obedience. When you're obedient, you eat the good of the land.
What happens when you refuse and rebel?
What does the scripture say? When you're obedient, you eat the good of the land. If you refuse and rebel, you will be destroyed. And so it is today. Obedience.
Obedience is so much better than sacrifice. Okay. 22. When the days of her purification according to the law of Moses were accomplished, they brought him to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every male that openeth the womb shall be called holy to the Lord. And to offer a sacrifice according to that which is said in the law of the Lord. A pair of turtle doves, a few young pigeons. And behold, there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. The same man was just and devout, and he was waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Ghost was upon him. Verse 26, you're going to hear a prophetic revelation to Simeon. And it was revealed unto him by the Holy Ghost that he should not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ.
You realize the Holy Ghost was dealing with people back in that day.
How many of you does the Holy Ghost deal with? We're going to have an increase of this if you participate. We're going to be giving more opportunities for you to walk in the manifestations of the Holy Spirit. Prophets had training even back in that day.
I don't need nothing. He don't need nothing.
Yes, you do. You need everything you can get. All right. Verse 27. And he came by the Spirit into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him after the custom of the law, then took he him up in his arms, and he blessed God and said, Lord, now lettest thou thy servant depart in peace according to thy word, for mine eyes have seen thy salvation.
We're going to stop right there. Those of you that are wanting to be a mouthpiece for God, don't overlook children.
Amen.
I prophesy and pray over children in the highway, byway, hedge. We went on a cruise, and as soon as I put my suitcase and everything came out of the room, I saw a family, husband, wife, a little boy, and the Holy Ghost began to deal with me. I said, can I pray for your children? The lady said, yes, yes. And she ran up to me and she said, oh, I don't know. What name? I said, the name of Jesus. She said, he come over, Washa. I began to prophesy. And after a time, people started coming up to me this way and that. We were blocking the aisle for people to get out and go to the elevator in the other quarter. But I just kept ministering and everybody stood there respectfully. Then I started hearing people praying in the spirit.
You don't know who knows God up and down the church hallway.
Come to find out, both of those children, the Spirit of the Lord showed me, were prophets. And I was so privileged to speak the mantle of them. You need to have eyes to see God's people. Some of them you'll meet in the raw, drunk, stinky, toe down. Such were some of us. We're in all kinds of states and conditions. But God is bringing us on this journey and drawing us. Christmas story is a story that should be lived every day of your life because Christ is in you and I'm working through you and the Holy Ghost ought to draw me. And it should even be when you're a child. My piano teacher kept calling me and my mother would call me for the phone. She'd kind of be standing there half listening to me. She took the phone from me one day. She said, you call her often. She said, now I hear her practicing. Is there a problem? She said, I've never had to tell her to practice. I never had to tell her to do her homework. She's a self-motivated, self-starting child. But I called her. She said, now it's 7. Yeah, she said, Do you know your child is a prophet? And she said, I know God uses them. She said, well, honey, she came in here playing piano, taking her lesson. The next thing I know, she telling me everything I had asked God about for the last 2 days, telling me the answer. She said, and I wanted to make sure I own this thing right. So I was just calling. And my counseling ministry started as a child. And my sister Yulia would get so upset with me when I was in upper elementary and she was in junior high. We only had one phone and it had a party number. And when the phone would ring, it would be people calling me for counseling. This is the truth. And she said, Mama won't let us, she got me. Mama won't let us call no boys. So we got to wait for them to call us. And you are on the phone. The Holy Ghost would just draw. The spirit of counsel would draw. But my parents drove foolishness out of the heart with a rod of correction.
Oh, yeah.
That's right. Correction, correction, correction. So you can be meek for the master's choice. Is there any number today that wants to make spiritual business with God? You want to receive Christ as Lord and Savior. This is the most important thing you could ever do because it sets you up where your eternal life is spent with Him. We all have eternal life. Our spirit is eternal. But where will you spend eternity? That's what you're determining. When you receive Christ as Lord, that He'll come for you. He said, I prepare a place for you. Do you know that people that aren't in full fellowship with God are scared of that day? You don't have to live in fear. God said He'd deliver you from a fear of death when you walk with Him and know what, when He calls you home to your mansion, why are you going to argue and say, I just want to go down to Crenshaw one more time? I have a friend, some of you better, the other day, Pastor Velda Turner from Texas, the first time she came to Los Angeles, coming from here, are you going to take me down to Crenshaw? I just want to see Crenshaw. She said, because you know, the Shaw is always wrong. I said, Crenshaw is torn up. I don't care. There are so many things that are blown up out of proportion that it's a disgrace, but not heaven.
Amen.
No bills. Say hooray.
Hooray!
No crying. Say hooray.
Hooray!
No dying.
Hooray!
Hooray! No sickness.
Hooray!
No disease.
Hooray!
No con men.
Hooray!
No scam artists.
Hooray!
No folk calling on the phone solicitors every few minutes and waking you up and all that. Amen. Amen. So we have to get ready down here. We have to get ready down here and treasure Christ and put Him first. Is there anyone today that wants to receive Jesus as Lord? Anyone today that wants to bring yourself into identification with Christ through water baptism? Anyone today? Is there anyone today that wants to be filled with the precious Holy Spirit? With the New Testament evidence of speaking with tongues as the Spirit of God gives you the language. Anyone today? Anyone today that would like to have a church home with a family of believers? You know, the church is a family. It is a family. It is a family. And your relationships in this family will be just what you make them. Just like in your own family. You bring peace, there you go. Have some peaceful relationships. You bring huggable, oh, bless you and your huggable. But it's a family. Amen. God is here and He has a plan. And He said not to forsake fellowship with believers as something. Is there anyone that desires to have a church? This time we'll welcome Dr. Ramona Brooks to lead in our Holy Ghost meeting.
Is the baby here yet?
Raise your hand, ushers will serve you. Sir, there are a lot of hands. One of you young men help the ushers give envelopes. There are a lot of hands.
Right,
sometimes it's important for us to remember that young men in particular need to be kept busy. Amen. Or they're going to find something to be busy about. How many of you were ever young? I know y'all want to claim a certain age now, but you know, but if you tell the truth, somebody told me last night they stayed 25 for 4 years. When my former pastor stayed 28 for I don't know a lot of years, and then when his daughter was a year older than he got 28, I asked him what was he gonna do. And he just started laughing. Then when I turned 28, I said, what are you gonna do with that? You got to move on up now. Because all of us cannot be 28. Thank the Lord for every day that He allows you to live. And don't disregard it. The turkeys are available, and I need you to participate by cooperating and following the instructions. This is not intermission. Thank you so much. So we're going to ask you, as soon as we are dismissed, to go to the fellowship hall, and Chandra will tell you or give you your bag. The turkeys have been put in the bag so that you can carry them easily. And she'll have a list and check you off. So that would be Rose Williams, Janelle Rogers, Pastor Johnson, Pat Stanford, Terry Taylor. I'll see her. She'll be at Living Waters, so in the Diversity Society. Michael's guardian, I don't know who that is. I guess this is one of his auntie. Yeah, okay. Is Carl back there? Okay, can you get Angels, please? All right. So, Chandra, give Jesse Angels. And then there's one for her as well.
Thank you.
So we have Jesse, hers and Angels. Okay. Is there anyone else who signed up? Your name was crossed off, your grandson crossed your name off, so I guess he gave it to you. I gave it to Pops. He gave it to Pops. Yeah, he gave it to you. Yes, Linda. You signed up. Okay, he has unknown. There's a writing name, so you go to the back.
Yeah.
Sorry. He said he didn't remember who was on his list. Young people and old ones as well. What I'm saying to you now is something that you got. It. Okay. Understand, these smartphones are not always smart. And sometimes it's a good idea to write things down in a place that you can remember.
Because when it peers out, guess what? All the information is lost. And so, don't depend on your smartphones for everything without a backup. Say backup.
Backup.
It's one of the things I tell folks who want to debate about Jesus and whether he's Lord or not. I've got a safety net. I've got a backup. You say it's not so, I say it is. Just in case. I got a backup. Amen. Hallelujah. Have all given?
No, we still wait.
No.
Yes, ma'am.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Thank you. Personally. I'm holding this basket to receive greeting cards from those of you who wish to give your pastors, Pastor Johnson and Dr. Woods, and you want to do it in separate cards. We have plenty of cards. You can give them a personal greeting without including a love offering. Some people, you might want to give a love offering in January. We're going to be specifically requesting this Sunday and the remaining Sundays in December. And I just want to share a quick testimony. We had prayed the second Sunday when we made the announcement that for anybody that wanted to participate in the giving for our pastors, and it's for Christmas, it's for appreciation for 40 years. I'm thankful that we didn't have a fundraiser so I could go on the cruise with my money. I've given to our pastors, but it bears repeating. Some churches, 10th anniversary, 5th anniversary, let alone the 40th anniversary, you would be saving money to send them on a cruise for the next 40 years and doing things. And I don't say that to judge. I just say that I personally marvel that Pastor Johnson's vision was, I want the people to go on a cruise. And I never heard a word about Shira, Dr. Woods saying, now if y'all want to take up a love offering on the cruise or something like that, none of that ever happened. I'm just saying that to say their vision of their prosperity is that Jesus Christ our provider, and they have decreed that over themselves, over us. And I just encourage you to participate in the giving of kind words, if that's all of this time God needs you to do. And for those who have it and are willing, then quite naturally your gifts will be appreciated. We have cards that are available free of charge. You can just raise your hand if you'd like a card for whatever purpose to give to our pastors. And you can do that quickly. The reason we wait is that the first priority is tithes and offerings. So if you haven't given a tithe or an offering, this call is for you to just write some words in there. Because see, we still, all these lights, we decree that y'all will give so that they won't get cut off. See, y'all don't know nothing about that, but I grew up with kerosene lamps and all of that. You know, you come home, you flip the switch, you didn't even like, Mama, what happened to life we knew? Okay, unfortunately. Somebody, we just went to get the kerosene lamp because, you know, the bill didn't get paid. So tithes and offerings, that's what keep us prosperous. So again, if anyone would like to give, the next two Sundays we'll be doing this, and we certainly appreciate those who have given and will be given, and may God give you a hundredfold return. Just by way of clarification, the call or the invitation to give is for our pastors, and some brought cash. And if you could let me know, one, did you intend it to be in the basket for our pastors? And two, who were you giving the cash to? If you want to divide it equally, just come and let me know. You can do that at the end of service. Thank you.
Want to be obedient to the Spirit of the Lord. As Pastor was giving the invitation and as she was giving the sermon, the Lord spoke to me regarding the seed of Patrice Edwards. And Leah Bellmaster, do you mind coming? Because I have a ministry for you to stand proxy for your family and your children. And I would invite those that know how to pray in the spirit. That will come not only to you, but to the seed of the righteous. Because it's promised that as my house is saved, that as I'm saved, my household will be saved. And I heard the Lord say there will be a restoration relative to the prophetic gifts that you have always walked in. And it was desire of your mom to see her children walk in the fullness of their giftings. And the Lord reminded me of a 7-year-old girl that was in the parking lot when we were over by the hospital. And a friend of mine, who I didn't even know was in deep addiction, was standing and had come to our church. And you skipped past him and stopped. And you ministered to him the word of life and just skipped off. And he said, that little girl said everything about what's going on in my life. That little girl was you. And you used to prophesy. You would sit in the classroom and the kids would be lying about what they did or what they didn't do. And you said, y'all lying, you know you did. And you would call out righteousness. And I want to just pray with you regarding that. Receive ye the Spirit of the Lord. That as your household is saved, you will be saved. That your mouthpiece will save many, will deliver many. And as you stand proxy for the seed of your mother, your mother's mother, God said there's no weapon formed against you all that's going to prosper. No weapon, he said, and make a cry in the spirit realm to repent, to give back that which was lost. And he said, you're going to do it by godly living. You're going to do it by the prophetic on you. And that you're going to stir up the gift that's not only with you, but in your seed. And you stand proxy right now for the household of Patrice, because she demanded heaven for this. And we just thank you and we praise you, Father, for her obedience. We thank you for covering her with your peace. We thank you for calling out the gifts that they'll be stirred up in this generation and the generations to come. And we mandate it. And we take back what the enemy stole. We take back what the enemy has stolen. And we thank you, take back what the enemy has stolen. And we just thank you and we praise you for it. In Jesus' name. You stand here. And the Lord says to every child here, have your children stand right now. They're under 21. Have them stand right now. And receive it. Have them stand right now. Have them stand right now. And receive the mandate of the anointing of God on their lives. That no weapon will be formed that will prosper against them and their ministries. And that God, that they will have long life. Long life. And they will walk in the calling of God on their lives. And we take witness to that right now. Y'all stretch your hands to a child that's standing. And we will undo the work of the enemy that will speak anything but, I will walk in the glory and the holiness of God in my lifetime. In Jesus' name. Hold on.
I need to validate something, Leah. I was at your dedication at First Apostolic Church of Englewood when your mother requested Pastor Davis to shut down the entire afternoon for your dedication as a prophet. And it wasn't understood at that time by me many, but your mother knew. And Pastor Davis validated that and did as she requested. That afternoon be shut down for your dedication. God has had his hand on you. He's refused to take it off of you. Though you may have turned, you've come around 360. And God is going to do what he has set out to do and desire to do. And your mother's prayers will never go unanswered concerning her children, her grandchildren, her seed. The Lord says, I love you with an everlasting love. There is nothing you could ever do or say that would change my mind. And you can take that to the bank, baby. God's gonna do miracles in the world. In Jesus' name. Can you see that?
I just want to say something. I just want to say something. I want to thank God for Pastor Johnson for her teaching us to, when we hear the Lord, to be obedient. I wasn't even in California when this was that child was dedicated, but I heard the Lord saying that this was a prayer for Mother, and not only for her but for her seed. Brother Collins, he said he's impressed.
In the name of Jesus, I break every word curse, every hindrance, every attack of the enemy. I break and bind crop failure. I break and bind every entity, every fallen angel, every attack from the wicked one against Leah Bellmaster. I cancel it right now in the name of Jesus. Father God, I thank you that you're dealing with your handmaiden with through her spirit, through her heart, Father God. I thank and praise you, Father, that you are moving in the earthly realms, situations and circumstances and hindrances and bondages in the natural realm, that you're moving them out of the way materially and financially, emotionally, spiritually. Father God, we release your presence and your blessing and your will to be manifested in her life right now in the mighty name of Jesus. I declare and decree the peace of God that passes all understanding to be in her mind, in her heart, in her emotions, and in her body in the name of Jesus. Clear vision, clear vision, clear vision. In the mighty name of Jesus. Father God, we thank you. We thank you for affirming your handmaiden and setting her forth on the path of, victory and success in Jesus' name. Amen.
I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand. I'm just going to ask you to receive.
Amen.
Pastor had an unction about addictive strongholds. And we're going to pray. Let me tell you that the prayer is ineffective if you don't heal. You have to surrender
you have to yield. I'm not even going to ask you to stand up, because some folks,
I ain't going back to that church. They point you out.
I'm not going to do that. But you know who you are, and you know what you are, what you have a tendency toward addiction in. I don't smoke, and I don't drink. You do something that you can't do without. That may be even a coffee addiction. Whatever it is you can't do without, it's called an addiction. Hello?
Hello.
Him, her, them, it. I'm telling you, it's a monkey on your back, and you don't have to live with it. Jesus died. You're celebrating Christmas, and people celebrate this as the time of Jesus' birth, but listen, we need to get it straight. Jesus was not born on December 25th. Number one. Number two, that is totally immaterial. The fact is that he was born. The fact is that he lived and he died on Calvary so that we wouldn't have to live a defeated life. And we could live without these issues that try to harass us and do. He shed his blood that you could be set free. So those of you who want to let go of addictions, I'm telling you, he'll do it. He delivered me from coffee, Cokes, fried chicken. Those were my deviations from normal living. I felt like I couldn't do a day without a Coke. I've been 6 months now without Coke. I thought I couldn't do without coffee, black coffee. I ain't talking about water with coffee in it or some little creamy stuff y'all like. I'm talking about black coffee, real straight up. No chaser, right? Just straight up. And I thought I couldn't do without it. But I've been 20-something years without it. Only God. Now I'm gonna drop this on you because some of y'all like to get real spiritual and deep. But I thought my life was ended when my husband said he didn't want to be married anymore. Some of y'all would get that later. I was sold out to be celibate and not to be promiscuous. My youngest daughter, well, she don't want me to tell her anything, so I won't. But anyway, it has been 30-something years that the Lord has blessed me not to have uncles over them. Somebody will get that later. Don't have a sugar daddy. We're too old now, listen. Ain't nothing old about me, but my hair is great. Okay? I'm just saying. You have to commend your way to the Lord and you have to be volitional about it. I'm not saying anything is easy. What I'm saying is putting his yoke upon you makes it easy. Amen. Tell somebody you don't have to yield yourself to anything that will not bring God glory. Amen. I didn't think I could live without a man. I knew I needed one. I just knew that in my head. Y'all don't hear what I said. I said I thought I needed one. But God will say yes where you say no. And even when you've cursed yourself, and many of us have done that, he'll still, in the midst of that, turn it around. Come on, tell somebody he'll turn it around. How many witnesses do I have? He'll turn it around. Whatever that thing is, whatever.
whatever that monkey is, he'll get it off your back and turn it around. So Father, in the name of Jesus, we take authority over every addictive spirit that would harass your people in the name of Jesus. And those, Lord God, who are sincere about their surrender and their release, I thank you that you're taking the desire and the taste of those things, those ones, away from them in the name of Jesus. We speak to every curse in Jesus' name. Those who have spoken them against themselves, along with those who have been spoken against these ones. We thank you that they fall to the ground unaccomplished. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you for your blood covering. In Jesus' name, we give you glory. We give you honor. We give you praise. In Jesus' name. Now repeat after me, Father.
I let go
of everything that would overwhelm me, that would be addictive to me, and I release it to you. Take it. I give it to you. And I receive in its place your healing, your victory, your joy. In Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Praise God. Come on, clap your hands if you receive that. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
He's real. Come on, tell somebody he's real.
He's real.
All right. We're going to go. Yeah. All right. Joyce has some words.
Praise the Lord. On Thursday, this coming Thursday, December 20th at 7 p.m., the Christian Performing Arts Center is having their annual dance concert. It's $20 for adults. They're the group they've been coming for years to our Praise Him in the Dance program. They're magnificent. I've seen the Christmas program before. It is awesome. And it's in the Valley at Birmingham High. It's worth the drive and it's worth the money. So Kimberly Abrams is the director. So if you're interested, please see me today. Thank you.
It's Christmas.
A special treat next week during our morning worship service. There are people that have received gifts from God. The Bible says God gives gifts to men, different gifts. And I'm calling on the comedic gifting to help us with our Sunday morning service next week. Because a merry heart doeth good like a medicine. So I'm just trying to pique your interest. Don't miss it. Also, if you haven't talked to me, but you want to participate in this because you have been given by God a comedic gifting, and comedy is an area. Some of you have dry wit, some other kind of wit. You know, humor varies, you know, but 40 years in ministry now, I have learned. I remember one time we had a talent show at church, a Christian talent show, and a lady, she was new to the church. She'd been here about 3 months. And she said, Pastor, I want to do praise dancing. I signed her up. She was so excited. She had two little beautiful dogs. I said, are they going to dance with you? No, just me. Just me. And every evening she called me. Pastor, I just got in from work. I had to hurry, feed my kids, and help them with their homework, put them to bed, because I'm giving an hour in rehearsing for this. Can't wait till next Sunday to do my praise dance. So this is when we were over at 8711 Harvard. When we had this tarp for a roof over an outside area. And
And oh, she called me every day. Oh, Pastor, I'm so tired. But I'm being diligent about this. So, y'all taught me how to pastor. Y'all really did. So the day finally came and they put that music on when it was her turn. And she gave the tape to somebody. And I heard this music. Da-da-dum-da-dum, dum-dum. You and Mickey's monkey, baby. The next thing I know, she's squatting down and bumps and grinds and all on the ground doing Mickey's monkey. Praise music made me different to different people. And I was in such a state of shock, I couldn't even make her sit down. You know, Jesus learned by the things he suffered. I have suffered much. So, if you want to participate in this, I have to hear your presentation by Wednesday. By Wednesday. Another man, a leader in God, he I told him one time, I said, I want to be comedic because God really uses you. I walked out the room. When I came back on that day, his message was pornographic. And I said, what? Now, I'd been in the ministry a little longer. I wasn't born, so I said, cut it. He said, but Pastor, it's so funny. I said, it's so filthy. So, I'll let you know if I approve of what you do. So call me. But if you haven't talked to me, let me know that you want to prepare something so I can expect to hear from you no later than Wednesday. And then I'm going to sit you down if you change it up there. Integrity is important. Okay, Dr. Lewis. We're not doing Mickey's monkey.
These days, I cut the music. Sit down. You'll sing amen. Praise God. Whoa. Don't worry about that Shabbat. Hey, we're talking about converting some of the VHS tapes into DVDs and have a time of gathering so that those of you who've never seen Mothers, the beginning, the beams, and the other presentations that have come forth. SC Prep Plays, all of those things, you'll be able to see them because we've been blessed. Come on, tell somebody, we're blessed. Yeah, and some of us have memories of those things. Some of you have been around all that time. And then there are others who have not. And so they would really be blessed, I think, by seeing what our history has been. Amen?
Yeah.
Amen. All right, would you stand? Let's go. Some of you were brought up in the Baptist environment or Pentecostal environment, and we're going to sing a little song as we prepare to leave. I call Jesus Wonderful Counselor. Oh,
Glory, hallelujah, to the Lord.
Father, we give you praise. We thank you that as we leave this place, we don't leave your presence. But we thank you that goodness and mercy follows us in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord God, that we go forth reporting victory in Jesus' name, walking in victory in the name of Jesus. Thank you that we're covered by the blood of the Lamb and that the angels of the Lord are encamped around and about us, keeping us from hurt, harm, and danger in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord, that those who are infirmed or who are being challenged, Lord God, that they are healed and made whole and have the physical manifestation of it from the crown of their heads to the soles of their feet, inside and out, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And as we go, Father, thank you that we are made to be blessings to others. So thank you that we will bless others even as you've blessed us. We give you all the glory, all the honor, in Jesus' name, amen. The Lord bless you and the Lord keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and give you his peace.